Good morning. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to NASA headquarters for the My Community, Our Earth SERVIR Global Fellowship Program capstone event, the first of its kind occasion where today we celebrate a global program carried out over the past 2 years in four different regions on our planet, in East Africa, the Himalayas, West Africa, and Southeast Asia, highlighting how students around the world are applying remote sensing, GIS, GPS, and geospatial data to address pressing environmental issues and the impact of climate change in their regions. These 14 young innovators who hail from 10 different countries were down-selected from 120 MICO participants, and today they will showcase their student-led work and demonstrate the power of geospatial data and geospatial thinking. Please let me introduce some distinguished guests from NASA here with us today. We have Nancy Searby, who is the Capacity Building Program Manager, and Dan Schumacher, who is the Director of the Marshall Space Flight Center Science and Technology Office. Also, I'm pleased to announce that the NASA Administrator is planning to meet with our MICO fellows this afternoon up in the ninth floor area. Before the MICO fellows present, we have some remarks from NASA, USAID, and the Association of American Geographers. I'm very pleased to introduce Mike Freilich, the NASA Earth Science Division Director in the Science Mission Directorate. Mike has not only led the expansion of NASA's Earth observations, but he's been very passionate about ensuring their utility for societal benefit.
Thanks very much, Dan, and welcome everyone to this MICO capstone event. To our distinguished student guests, I think that I speak for all of us on the panel when I say, we wish that we were you. Not just because you're young and energetic and passionate and smart, but also because you're coming of age, professional age, at a unique and critical time. You can and you will be making a difference for all of humanity. You're the first generation of scientists and engineers to have available observing systems, many from the vantage point of space, that provide truly global information. Our satellites allow unprecedented views of the Earth, not just of the details of individual processes, but of the interactions between the processes that actually define this complex planet on which we live. In 2014 alone, NASA is going to be launching 5 major Earth observing missions. And today, later today, our international European partners will be launching the first of their Sentinel series of Earth observing satellites. So you have the measurements. You also have access to copious computational power, allowing you to rapidly complete calculations that your professional predecessors, that's like us, okay, could only dream about when we were your age. You have, and you use, maybe to excess, communication tools, allowing each of you to be aware of everything that's happening globally, not just locally, allowing you to access distributed information from diverse sources, and allowing you to forge international collaborations, bringing the best minds on the planet to bear on your investigations. On the other hand, you're faced with profound challenges, so maybe you don't have it so good. It will be up to you and your generation to define and propel all of humanity along a path that will enable our species to feed itself and to raise the quality of life for everyone, even as we are preserving and improving the planet's environment for your children and for future generations. You know, humans are the only species that can change what we do today based on our predictions of what's going to happen generations into the future. That's a profound responsibility. People are going to care about your predictions. They're going to be determinative for society and for the Earth's future. What you do is going to be important. Please get it right. Okay? I and we look forward to learning from you today and actually for many, many years into the future. So thank you for coming. And we are proud at NASA of our partnership with USAID that builds on each agency's innovative strengths. And so now I turn it back to Dan Irwin for an introduction of Bill Breed.
Thank you, Mike. And also, I do want to announce that we are pleased to have John Grunsfeld here, the Associate Administrator for Science, who actually had the opportunity to visit one of the SERVIR hubs in Kathmandu late last year. Next, I am very pleased to introduce Bill Breed with the U.S. Agency for International Development. Bill has been a key champion of SERVIR over the past several years, which has led to these rounds of MICO and, of course, SERVIR as a global network. Please join us, Bill.
I'm going to be very brief. First, I'd like to say I'm very glad to be here to represent USAID and as part of this ambitious program that we're working with NASA. Really, I think this is a really fundamental and groundbreaking program. And obviously, one of the opportunities is here represented by these students. Our vision in the Climate Change Office is to bring practical application and innovation of science and technology to improve development outcomes in a very dynamic world. But the story here today, and for our event tomorrow at AID, is these students, their ingenuity, persistence, and their excellence as represented by being selected out of a much larger group. As a global community looking forward, we're looking for innovations to improve decision making in this increasingly complex and connected world. And it's going to take innovators and creative minds, exemplified by these students, to use science and technology to overcome previous gaps and limitations to come up with better livelihoods and development outcomes. And leave it more to the students.
Thank you, Bill. And finally, I'm very pleased to introduce Patricia Solis with the Association of American Geographers. And Patricia is really the person behind the curtain that has led to the growth and success of MICO.
Thank you, Dan. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I am just thrilled to be here and thrilled to be present with our 14 fellows from the My Community, Our Earth, MICO, SERVIR Global Fellowship Program. I think you'll be inspired by their stories. We have been. You'll hear from them some of the challenges that they have been facing and what they've been doing about it. And they'll tell you a little bit about some of the impact that they've been having. But first, I want to make a comment about why I think that their participation in this program is helping them amplify that impact. First of all, we thank USAID and NASA for their belief in this program because we share with them this understanding that geospatial data and technologies are very powerful for being able to identify environmental problems and also design solutions, especially in a changing global climate. We also share with you your belief that young people have an extreme responsibility and power to address these issues, and we think they're taking the reins of leadership today, not at some point in the future. So we'll hear from them about that. Thank you for your support. Also, I think one of the things that makes this work is that it's a public-private partnership, and we have been working through the design of this program for many years with the input and insights of many people from around the world. This includes our U.S. university professors who share their knowledge, the personnel at the SERVIR regional hubs, the wonderful, tremendous staff at AAG, and the participants themselves, not just the fellows, but they all have mentors in their home institutions who've been working every day to make this better. I've never stopped asking the question, how do we make this better? And so through these evaluations and improvement continuously, I think we have a really tremendous experience for the students and a tremendous program. And finally, I think most importantly, The students themselves, the fellows themselves, have tremendous insights and passion and energy, and they, through this platform, have been able to connect with each other. And I think that that's a really powerful thing, and we're very inspired by them, and we hope you enjoy the presentations.
Thank you, Patricia. And now is what you've been waiting for, to hear from the MICO fellows themselves. And after the fellows from each region present and provide their short presentation, we'll have a few minutes to take questions from the audience and those of you watching online on NASA TV. If you'd like to ask a question via Twitter, just use the hashtag AskNASA. First, I am pleased to introduce from our East Africa team, Sabla, Susan, and Sedenya. The East Africa team focused on climate change and agriculture and food security, which are pressing issues in that region. In East Africa, agriculture accounts for 40% of GDP, and climate change is expected to have far-reaching consequences for the poor and for marginalized groups.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sabla from Ethiopia. I'm doing my master's degree in environmental science from Addis Ababa University. And my study was conducted in Wafasha Natural Forest, which is found around 195 kilometers away from Addis Ababa, which is the capital city of Ethiopia. And the total carbon, the problem that makes do the research was, unlike other developed countries, Ethiopia is lacking a periodic forest inventory data, and that makes the country fails to enhance the carbon stock potential of different forests. The total carbon stock of the study was measured by measuring the amount of carbon stock in the above ground biomass, below ground biomass, in the leaf litter, and soil organic carbons. And the forest cover change was also detected by using different years Landsat imageries. And from the results, the forest have a good potential for potential carbon stock, and it has a good potential for climate change mitigation and also for carbon trade. And the money from carbon trade may be important for the government, and it may be also important for the local communities and the rural livelihoods, and it may also promote the good forest governance. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. I'm honored to represent my country. My name is Susan Malaso from Kenya. Now, as agriculture continues to dominate as the mainstay for the economies of many developing countries, Kenya in particular is a classic example that so much depended on agriculture to support its growing population. However, frost is a perennial agricultural hazard that continues to limit productivity of crops within the Aberdare and Mount Kenya regions of Kenya, are causing a lot of damage and losses for farmers. These have been aggravated by lack of information on frost and its probability of occurrence, as well as dynamics, leading to losses and a negative economic impact for the farmers. My project demonstrates the role of modest land surface temperature data by mapping frost hotspots within the Aberdare and Mount Kenya regions, as well as establishing the trend of occurrence for the minimum temperatures. This is in an aim to identify the areas that are most frequented by minimum temperatures, and I advise on our measures for farmers to take in order to avoid the losses. The findings of my project resonated well with the indigenous knowledge and experience of farmers regarding the spatial and temporal occurrence of frost and the landscape characteristics that are most frequented by the minimum temperatures. Now, with this information, the farmers are able to employ measures to avoid frost damage to crops by initiating measures that include use of greenhouse gases, induction of wind breezes, and sprinkler irrigation. The success of analyzing climatic data to come up with the frost probability maps has enlightened me on even greater possibilities of integrating this information into index-based insurance programs for farmers, as well as advisory services against weather hazards like frost and drought, which are rampant in Kenya. Thank you.
I want to thank you all for this great opportunity. I feel really privileged. Thank you so much. My name is Adania Bebe. I'm from Ethiopia. My project is about assessment of flood frequency and local adaptation practices. We all people take risks. We all do. But the community, the people in this community take risks to the extent of losing their life, because their livelihood depends on the flood recession farming, which is risky very much. Because when the flood is too much, it gets risky, and if it gets fewer, also it is risky more than for more than itself. So what I was doing was, I was assessing the flood frequency and also look at the trends of the temperature and also the rainfall trend at the local level. So assessing this, I have found out that at this specific place, there is really the climate change, because the trend shows, especially for the minimum temperature, the trends are increasing. So it's accelerate the risk of the people living by this flood site. And also, I used to analyze this trend, I used both station data and grid data. Also, your grid data helped me so much to evaluate and change the detection spatial extent. Also, I used the Landsat imageries, the Landsat satellite imageries to identify the land cover and land use change. Also, to analyze the trends too. That shows that farming land is expanding in a great significant, so it is affecting the discharge flows in that area. So finally, I shared the result with the National Meteorology Agency. We have talked about the quality of the data, especially on the station data, and also what the services could be given for the local people from these local stations. And also, we have made a talk with the local governments, the small governments level. We have a talk about how to increase the forest coverage of the area, and also we have talked about how we can make the community beneficiary from this afforestation activities, because there's no one would be pleased to give or to sacrifice their livelihood for the uncertain future, because they got to live it today. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. And do we have any questions from the audience or via social media for the East Africa group? Okay, I have one. Susan, tell me a little bit more, if you'd be so kind, on, so you're using MODIS satellite data and helping to create frost potential maps, and I understand the work that you're doing is leading towards forecast products as well. So can you tell us a little bit how the farmers might use this information, especially in the context of the tea crop, which I understand is one of the largest crops in Kenya?
When the farmers have the information on where the frost is most likely to occur, or where the minimum temperatures are frequent, they are able to employ measures that avoid frost damage to the tea. For example, use of sprinkler irrigation and inducing wind. Yeah, and the farmers can also take up insurance cover for the crops.
Fantastic. Thank you very much. Okay. Next, I am pleased to introduce our Himalaya team, Lakpa, Prasamsha, Joyita, and Pramila, and the Himalaya group focused on climate change in mountain regions. The Himalayas are often referred to as the third pole, or the water tower of the world, providing water from snowmelt to over 1 billion people.
My name is Lakba, and I represent Bhutan. The project title I have taken is Linking Traditional Beliefs on Climate Change to Scientific Understanding for a Better Adaptation Strategies. And this project is of a greater concern because the study area is experiencing a sort of weather abnormalities. But nevertheless, the local communities seems to be very less aware about it, and they remain sticking to the age-old traditions of inclining towards spiritual, adaptations, which will not be a good measures for a long-term sustainable living. Thus, what I have done in the project is I have conducted a detailed survey and focal group discussion in order to document the perception and beliefs of the local people about climate changes and the impact of climate changes. I have also analyzed the physiographic and climatic data, including land use and land cover changes, in order to construct a better understanding in a scientific perspective about the climate change. And I have shared the concept note and the preliminary findings with the SERVIR Himalayan Youth Forum at Sherabzi College in Bhutan. And the major impact of this project includes giving me extra opportunity to learn more about how to carry research works. And it has also given me a sort of insight to understand about the hardship that local communities are facing to make their living in the midst of changing climates. And generally, this project has provided a basis for further scientific discourses by incorporating the local or the indigenous beliefs and perception of the people in the local communities about climate change. And indeed, this project was really great. Thank you so much.
Namaste, my name is Prasamsha Thapa. It is an honor for me to represent my country, Nepal, in this platform. And my country, Nepal, which is already well known with its highest peak of the world, Mount Everest. I have just graduated in BSc Honors Environmental Science degree from Kathmandu University, and my research topic is surface area variation and climatology of Thorolpa Glacial Lake using remote sensing and GIS in Dolakha District, Nepal. Glaciers and glacial lakes are good indicators of climate change. Thorolpa Glacial Lake is formed by the retreat of Trikating Glacier in the northern Nepal at an altitude of 4,546 meters above sea level. So this present study used Landsat images to calculate the area of Thorolpa Glacial Lake and the length of Trikating Glacier for the years of 1975 to 2012. So this temperature plays a major role for the rapid retreat of these glaciers, so surface temperature is also measured with the help of remote sensing techniques. A great deal of attention should be given to this particular lake, as this is one of the potentially most dangerous glacial lake of Nepal, and it has the tendency to trigger glacial lake outburst flood. And if it occurs, then it can sweep away 100 kilometers downstream and devastate lots of lives and properties. Prevention is always better than cure, so precautions should be taken before any catastrophe collapse occurs. And that's why my research particularly alerts people about the present status of Thorolpa Glacial Lake, as I have created a map which shows the area of Thorolpa Glacial Lake for 2012. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Joita Poddar from India, and I work with Himalayan glaciers. Talking of the Himalayan glaciers, they are on the focus of public and scientific debate. The prevailing uncertainties that surround the glaciers make it very, very difficult for us to ascertain which direction the glaciers are headed, whether they are retreating or whether they are advancing. So there is a lot of regional variability that is apparent in the Himalayan region. The glaciers of the western Himalayas are surging or at a standstill, while the glaciers of eastern or central Himalayas are retreating at a very fast pace. So a poor understanding of the factors that affect them and the diversity in the climatic conditions and the extreme topographic conditions that exist in Himalayas make the make it even more speculative. So it is in this context that I studied the glaciers of western Himalayas and tried to investigate whether the glaciers of the western Himalayas are showing the same retreating trend as the glaciers of other parts of the world, or are indeed more stable and gaining in size. So the major questions that arose at the onset of my study were: what is glacier health? What are the indicators or the parameters of glacier health? How do we quantify them? How do the glaciers of western Himalaya respond to the climate change in terms of linear, aerial, and volumetric changes? And what are the remote sensing techniques that could be used to map the debris cover accurately and to automatically extract and map the debris cover? Because debris cover is a very important component in the retreat and advancement of Himalayan glaciers. And my study also looked into the advanced digital image processing techniques which could be employed for glacier domain mapping. And I also tried to work with changes in mass balance and try to see whether the mass losses in glaciers would lead to a deterioration of the glacier health and how it can be monitored using satellite images. And overall, I tried to see the direction and the magnitude of changes in the glaciers of this region. So to answer these questions, I worked on three major parameters. There was snout retreat and advancement, and aerial changes within the glacier domain, and the variations in mass balance. For this, I emphasized on the creation of a glacier inventory and used multi-criteria techniques for extraction of accumulation zone and ablation zone of the glaciers, and also tried to extract the debris cover of the glaciers. So all these the study revealed that the glaciers in the western Himalayas are indeed at a standstill and not really retreating as is generally perceived. We also tried to see the socio-economic implications of the glaciers. So we studied the Changpa tribes, which inhabit Ladakh region. And we saw that the extreme snowing events are causing them to lose their habitat, and which is adversely affecting the wool production. These findings were communicated in a poster session at EC Mode in Nepal. Thank you.
Namaste and good morning. My name is Pramila Bodel and I'm from Nepal. So Nepal is a mountainous country and it lies in the lap of Himalayas. So is my study area, which lies in Dolakha district. So the problem in the area is glacier is melting at a faster rate. So impact is being seen in the downstream, like flooding and landslide is very usual. And this event is washing away all the agricultural lands. And the temperature is increasing at the rate of 0.02 degrees Celsius per year. And rainfall is decreasing at the rate of 0.35 mm per year. So it have led to the increased pest infestation and diseases in the area. And it have in turn decreased the productivity and the quality of crops like rice, maize, wheat, and barley is not good. And farmers are really upset with the phenomenon. And at the same time, the water shortage is being felt. There is no water to irrigate the land. And this have led to the decreased productivity in crops. And what I did was I carried a vulnerability assessment. I prepared a vulnerability map. I ranked whole area and they find out which one was the most vulnerable area in this study area. And what the impact what this work impact was, I could implement or I could make local adaptation plan. So we are going to formulate a local adaptation plan in my study area with the help of my supervisor who works under Nepal Climate Change Support Up Program. So my research is really very important because I could help people to adapt with the changing climatic stress. And thank you. And I'd like to thank AAZ, NASA, and USAID for providing me this opportunity to present my country and say about my research work. Thank you.
Thank you, and that's there's such fascinating research coming from such an important area of the world. Are there any questions from the audience or from social media? Okay, I actually, Lapka, I have one on the project that you're doing. I'm just curious. So as I understand, there's traditional beliefs, and you're bringing science-based information. So how is the openness to that science-based information in the community?
The people in the local communities were less speculate about the scientific understanding of the climate change. Rather, they are inclined and resolute that they stick upon the spiritual interventions like appeasing the local deities, offering sorts of sacraments, and then invoking rainfall at the times when there is no rainfall in the local communities, especially during the time of cultivation. But while looking at it from the scientific perspective, this sort of religious intervention may not be working now, because as and when we have looked at the rainfall pattern, there had been a lot of fluctuations and unpredictable patterns of rainfall regimes, and this could be some of the greatest problems that would devastate the livelihoods of the people, which needs to be informed before something gets late.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, next I am pleased to introduce our West Africa team, Wasiu, Rosalind, and Latifa, and of the West African group focused on women in climate change and food security. And climate change is affecting food security in West Africa, and the effect on men and women is very different, hence this specific focus on women and climate change. Wasiu.
Here. I'm Wasiu Alimi from Nigeria. The problem that my research addresses is human beings compelled by economic reasons, destroying the forest through encroachment and logging. That has caused serious reduction in abundance of tree species, leading to loss of biodiversity. Now, there are two major components of biodiversity. The loss, which I talk about, will occur across three stages: the genetic level, the specific level, and the ecosystem level. At the ecosystem level, two components will be affected: the abiotic component and the biotic component. The abiotic component, which include climatic parameters such as rainfall, temperature, and others, will keep undergoing changes that will be harmful or deleterious to the biotic component, which include flora, fauna, plants, animals, me, and you. And that is a major reason to care. If these changes continue, the abiotic component will lead to serious ecological and socio-economic problems like flooding, soil erosion, cessation of river and streams, destruction of wildlife habitats, and increased poverty, all of which would impact negatively on human health and well-being, another major reason to care. As we all know that every problem presents us with creative and innovative ways of solving, of presenting a solution. Sequel to obtaining relevant information, I carry out an assessment of the climatic and socio-economic impact of illegal logging in Hunigambari Forest Reserve, Ibadan. And I created maps and charts using climatic data from NASA New Earth Observations and georeference Landsat imageries from USGS GLOFIS. The results I found were amazing. The land use land cover maps produced show that the settlement in the study area had increased to about 79% from 1984 to 2013. The result of the normalized difference vegetation index I did also showed that vegetation height has decreased. Then I decided to carry out an outreach activity, which had in attendance women, men, ministries, NGOs, and other relevant bodies to share the result of my work with them. And they were so glad to be enlightened about how to make productive use of the forest without destroying the ecosystems. What I did also was to teach them on how to get other things from the forest. We called such things non-forest timber produce. And they were so glad about a program that enlightened them about how to make productive use of the forest without destroying the ecosystem and the need to preserve and conserve nature's resources. Another thing I did was to share the result of my work with ministries, and they were glad. They showed willingness to empower the local women through training on non-timber forest produce. It is very important that we need to develop, but my final message is, as we develop, let's not destroy the environment, because that is where we all belong. Thank you.
Good morning to you all. I'm Roselyn Bacha from Cameroon, and my challenge here is agriculture in urban areas is fastly gaining increased importance in recent times, but that is not the case in Yaoundé Fuzi region of Cameroon. This agriculture, this activity is that which is highly practiced by the urban poor who live in slums and ghettos. These urban poor people, they carry out this activity in swamps, vacant lots, and with a few exceptions as home gardens. The urban poor people are inevitable in society, so their needs and concerns are a call, you know, a look into. People have to look into that. As these farms that are being in the swamps, they're constantly being exposed to occurring flash floods, pests and disease prevalence, and all this is hampering the farm intensification and the food production process. Agricultural land use type in the Fundi area also faces high competition from the university graduates who, due to unemployment rates that are so high in Cameroon now, are questing over these lands as well to be able to carry out market gardening such that when they sell the produce of vegetables and tubers, they can generate some income to be able to take care of their daily needs. It's also worth mentioning that supply of food in the urban area based on royal production and imports is on the increase, but then again, it's not meeting the demands of the urban population, especially those of the poorer sectors whose purchasing power is quite low. In investigating these problems and this challenge, I did make use of satellite imageries. I carried out change detection analysis to bring out the time series data of the changing land use patterns, finding out how these patterns have changed and how it has affected the agricultural sector. I also did root cause analysis, and I carried out shared learning dialogues in the communities to find out the different dynamics that interplay and that interplay to bring about, interplay to ensure food security and food sufficiency. And here I did realize that the communities are suffering a whole lot because of the climatic changes, especially those of the flash floods that really disturb their farms. I now have an inner drive and a call to these communities and to the people that if we can come up with multi-sector support, we can improve on their activities through the creation of functional farmer group organizations. As well, I have a call to conscious capitalists to have a rethink of investing in this sector. Thank you.
Good day, ladies and gentlemen. I am Latifa Oyinlola from Nigeria. Raw and minimally processed fruits and vegetables are essential part of the human diet,
and the consumption has increased in the recent year because of the awareness of the health benefits. FAO 2002 reported that in developing countries, which Nigeria is one, fresh cut produce brings about the greatest concern in terms of microbiological hazard, because the industrial method of washing and sanitizing of fresh cut produce is ineffective once it has been infected with a microbial hazard from the farm. We need to care because climate change has been identified to have an impact on food safety hazard at different points of the food chain from farm to fork, which has an indirect effect on food security. During the course of my research work, I collected samples of fresh cut vegetables of interest from commercial farms in Lagos State, Southwestern Nigeria, between August and December 2013, which incorporated part of the raining and dry season period of the year. The samples were subjected to microbiological analysis using standard laboratory techniques, and the microbial results was compared with international microbiological specification for fresh cut vegetables. Microbial hazard was identified from the samples, though the severity differs between seasons. And I constructed a risk hazard map using ArcGIS 10.1 version. The information used on the map were the GPS coordinates of the farm, the microbial results gotten from the lab, and time series climatic data of the research period. I also train potential agricultural extension workers and farmers on how to minimize microbial hazard on a fresh cut vegetable farm, since this is a critical control point on the food chain. Also, a safety manual was drafted to serve as a guide for the trainers for subsequent training, so as to cover a wide area of farmers in a bid to minimize microbial hazard on fresh cut vegetable farm and ensure food safety and food security in fresh cut vegetable area. This research work has sprouted my interest to involve myself in adaptive and applied researches that better understand the effects of climate change on food safety and food security in general. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. And we're running a little tight on time, so we can take questions at the end. Finally, I am very pleased to introduce our last team, the team from Southeast Asia, and that is Panpeng, Saint Saint, Mayan, and Kwa. And the Southeast Asia group is focusing on climate change, landscapes, and watersheds. Whereas other groups have completed their research, the Southeast Asia MICO round is actually still in progress. And one of the most populated regions in the world, Southeast Asia, is perhaps one of the most vulnerable on the planet to climate change.
My research aims to know how people can survive to potential sea level change and the effects, the impact of sea level in Thailand is now an important issue. And sea level has increased in all my study sites, and most areas of them are flush. For the challenge and problem to conduct my research. Data collections on the field is difficult to do because local people don't trust outsiders. And collecting reliable information is one of my challenges that I had to be addressed, And network by calling NGO who studying in my study area to explain what study or activity is all about. Another challenge is less awareness of people to impact of climate change. To impact of sea level rise. And through this research, I can make them aware on impact of sea level rise and show them that sea level rise is the impact of, is the effect of climate change. Although it is natural process, but it is more human-induced. For the progress of my research, I still need to interview some officers of governments, of provincial governments. Finally, the impact which I got from this research. This research makes me aware that research based on collaboration of people require network working. Working alone may not be successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I'm Sing Sing. I come from Myanmar. My project area is one of the regionally most prominent wetland, which is thought to be the very fast approaching imminent environmental collapse due to improper agricultural practice. That's why my study focuses on famous floating garden, which is grown on the floating island and making all traditional grass and wheat and aquatic plant. So this is very ingenious and innovative biotechnology, but the lake cannot sustain excessive growth expansion of these floating gardens, so they need to be environmentally compliant. So main objectives of my project is to identify baseline saturation of the lake by mapping toward pollution and sedimentation. As the data analyzes, GIS technique and the remote sensing technique such as landsat imagery is used to provide comprehensive understanding of future and the present changes of the lake and ecosystem, such as rate of expansion of the floating garden and also changes in open water area of the lake. So the result will be shared through the outreach activity, such as look at NGO, traditional community, and the government department. So the project can provide public awareness for the sustainability of this floating garden business and also lake ecosystem. So it can support the decision-making process to maintain cultural diversity and also ecotourism of this beautiful lake. Thanks for listening.
Good morning, my name is Mayang. I'm from Vietnam. I'm so happy and glad to be the participate in Captain Event today. To begin with my story, I would like to tell you about Vietnam. In Vietnam, since the forest was gone, we people have to face with a lot of problems such as deforestation, biodiversity loss, rising sea level, and moreover, global warming. Fortunately, since 2010, Vietnam government implements a policy named Payment for Forest Environmental Services and be the first country in Asia to initiate the nationwide PFEF schemes. Based on this policy, Vietnam can increase the forest quantity and forest quantity, increase the forestry sector of contribution to national economy, reduce the burdens of forest management and forest protection, and moreover, increase social well-being. However, the method to assessing the change in forest resources have been limited, and it's very difficult to know how much money should be paid for forest owner. To deal with this problem, we apply the GIS technology and remote sensing. So our research proposed like application of GIS and remote sensing in payment for forest environmental services in Hương Sơn, Hà Tĩnh province in Vietnam. And we hope we contribute to a scientific basis, and moreover, to contribute to practical assessment of policy in Vietnam. Thank you so much.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Nguyễn Minh Khoa. I come from the Mekong Delta, Vietnam. This area is the last of petty rice and in Vietnam. Rice is the one of the main food in Vietnam, and changing petty rice area because of climate change is connected matter. The reason of this research is whether do expansion of petty rice affect to natural forest in here. And I use a satellite, my Landsat imagery to identify a spatial chain of battery ride over time, and that affect natural forest in this area, and its expected outcome is that the map of battery ride chain over and the reason changes between battery ride and natural forest. Otherwise, I will come to do the area to my field work and approach farmer to observe their real work and record their opinion to their to out their right field. I expect that this step will be helpful for my research and for familiar farmer who live every day in there and save their life in our field ride. And I also expect that this my research will helpful for someone who are interested in it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. I think we have time maybe for one question, perhaps by social media.
Okay, this is for the Southeast Asia group. Is it difficult to get access to the NASA satellite data that you used in your research?
Yeah, I'm used Landsat images for my research because it's by using Landsat images, I can understand more about changes of the lake area, and also it can support and strong mind results. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Are there any other questions from the audience? Yes. We have one back there.
I'm originally from Nigeria. Is the government very supportive of your efforts, or is it just for your classroom alone?
Yeah, I think the question was, is the government supportive of your efforts? From the gentleman from, I believe you said you're from Nigeria?
Yes.
Yes.
I work for NASA, I'm at the CFO
office. Wonderful. So I think it's, are the government supportive of the efforts that you're doing?
Yeah, because it can beneficial to not only for the local people, but also for the government, because it's what famous, very famous area for tourism. So my project, government can support my effort. Yeah.
Fantastic. Perhaps I think the microphone is out with the groups. Maybe a West Africa team, if you could also provide a comment on that, on the are the governments supportive of the efforts that you're doing in West Africa?
Yeah. Yes. Because during the outreach activity of my work, there was a time I had to get a base map of the study area from Ministry of Agriculture. And then one of the wonders of GIS is that it lets people see reality. Later, I went there to show them an updated map of the forest and the extent of depletion of forests. And they were, wow, is this the extent of deforestation? And then they began to ask questions. What can we do? How can we help you? Then they started the discussion about non-forest timber produce, how to empower the local women on making productive and sustainable use of forest resources through training on programs like snowy, bee production, and other things. So they show willingness. They were glad to see an updated map of their forest being produced, something that is not like a paper map now, something that is not static, something that is dynamic, something they can always point up to. Thank you.
Also, in addition to what he said, during the course of my project, I had to collect samples. I had to collect meteorological data from local meteorological station, and when I made my explanations that I wanted to make use of those data for my research work, they were happy to and they were very willing to make those data available for me. So the government is very supportive of the research work. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and I want to thank all of the MICO fellows. It's a hard act to follow, and I want to thank the audience and, of course, the people watching online. To me, it's really it's so exciting to see how future leaders from around the world are using remote sensing, using NASA data, using GIS, GPS, geospatial technologies to make a real difference in their corner of the world. Please join us now outside the auditorium. We have a poster session where the MICO fellows will be by their posters and can go into further details and, of course, for refreshments. And if you'd like more information about the SERVIR program, please visit us online at www.nasa.gov/SERVIR. Thank you very much.